Good morning. I've seen too many people smiling and shaking hands. I think we can do a little better. Good morning.
Good morning.
There we go. I am Lisa Hamilton. I am Vice President of External Affairs for the Annie E. Casey Foundation, and I'm also a trustee of the Jim Casey Youth Opportunities Initiative. So on behalf of both organizations, I'd like to welcome you to this briefing focused on financing best practices in child welfare. I suspect that you are here because you share our core belief that all children need a family that can keep them safe and support their development. We would hope all parents could provide that kind of nurturing environment for their children, but we know that child welfare agencies face the often daunting task of supporting families when they hit bumps in the road, finding temporary homes for children when they need to be removed, and then ensuring those children have a pathway home or to another permanent family. And we've got to support efforts to help those child welfare systems continue to improve the ways they fulfill those roles. So today, we'd like to share our ideas about ways to reform the federal financing system to support the use of best practices in a number of areas. The Annie E. Casey Foundation and Jim Casey Youth Opportunities Initiative have spent decades partnering with public systems on reform efforts, so we know that the practices we recommend are possible. We begin today with a presentation by Tracey Feild on best practices in child welfare, built on our own experiences and decades of research and analysis. Tracey is currently the director of the Foundation's Child Welfare Strategy Group, which provides consulting to state and county and city agencies to implement major system reforms. Prior to joining the Foundation, she spent 14 years as a consultant helping public child welfare agencies maximize federal funds. She was also a director of social service and child welfare in both Maryland and Ohio, and she's been a researcher at the Urban Institute evaluating social service programs. Following Tracey, Patrick McCarthy, who's president and CEO of the foundation, will present our child welfare financing proposal. Prior to becoming president, Patrick was senior vice president overseeing the foundation's work in multiple areas, including child welfare, juvenile justice, mental health, income security, and a number of other areas. He also managed strategic consulting and Casey Family Services, which was the foundation's direct service arm. In addition, Patrick has held prior roles as a consultant on system reform and strategic planning. He's been a professor of social work and a family therapist. And he's also been a public system leader. He served as the leader over child welfare, juvenile justice, and mental health for the state of Delaware. So they both bring quite a bit of experience to this conversation. Now, I'll give you a heads up now that you will each receive handouts that include a policy paper and a summary of our recommendations after Patrick talks. I wanted you to know you don't have to take notes, but we wanted to give you every reason to pay attention and listen while he speaks. Following their presentations, Gary Stangler, who's president of the Jim Casey Youth Opportunities Initiative, will moderate a panel discussion on the recommendations. You'll hear formal introduction of Gary and the panel later in the program, but let me just say I've had an opportunity to talk to many of those panelists this morning, and you are in for a real treat. I think they bring just a fantastic range of perspectives to these issues, and we are looking forward to the feedback that they provide and hope to get similar feedback from others of you as we move forward. We know that there are limits to our perspective, and we anticipate that there will be other ideas that can make our recommendations stronger. And so at the end of the program today, I'll talk about some of the ways we're hoping to get more of your feedback. So before I turn it over to Tracey, I'd like to acknowledge two people who have provided significant leadership in developing the ideas that you'll hear today. First is Teresa Markowitz, who is the Vice President of the Foundation's Center on Systems Innovation. It's the part of the foundation that's focused on improving child welfare and juvenile justice system, developing models that support family strengthening, and promoting the use of evidence-based practices. Teresa has enjoyed a long career in mental health and juvenile justice and child welfare. And before coming to the foundation, she was the commissioner for children and families in the state of Kansas and led that state through a significant child welfare reform. I'd also like to recognize Rob Gein, who is the Director of Policy Reform and Advocacy in the center that Teresa leads. He's a noted expert in child welfare research and policy, having had leadership roles at Child Trends, the Urban Institute, the U.S. Government Accountability Office, and as a visiting fellow with the House Committee on Ways and Means. So again, thank you all for being here. We hope that these ideas will foster dialogue and ultimately action that helps communities ensure that all children achieve the best possible outcomes and have lifelong connections to a caring family. Tracey?
Good morning. Let's get started here. Okay, so we know that all children do best in families, both in the short term and for their long-term development and well-being. That is clearly a value that all of us in this room believe. Kids connected to significant adults and learn the life skills of getting along with others, developing relationships, developing trusting relationships, and of successfully negotiating a complex world. Our work at the foundation has given us a broad, and I think everyone would agree, a well-grounded perspective on the strategies and practices that can be used in agencies to significantly help children and youth overcome their sometimes adverse childhoods or traumatic experiences of their youth. Through almost 20 years working with the Family to Family program in 17 states, we've helped install strategies and practices that have helped children and youth improve their life circumstances. Through Casey Family Services, our direct service arm, over 30 years in 7 states, we've learned how to help foster parents help children and families. Also, 12 years working with the Casey Strategic Consulting Group and the Casey Child Welfare Strategy Group, we've also worked in over 17 states and found ways to improve outcomes through catalytic change mechanisms. Our perspective and our experience across so many different systems has allowed us to identify and promote the strategies and practices that we know work to help improve outcomes for children and families and really help children succeed as adults. In terms of our placement decision-making processes, our thinking about foster care over the last 30 years has changed. It's evolved. We know that children should be removed only when necessary, balancing safety in the home with the trauma of removal. We know that strategies such as team decision-making have done a lot to help children remain at home and remain safely at home with their families, and that families can use their own resources to help keep children safe. Over the years, this has resulted in fewer removals nationally. We've seen those numbers decline. When removal is necessary, family and extended family should always be the first choice for placing children. And when children's own family is not available, then foster families should be the choice. Lots of agencies, lots of state and local agencies have reduced their use of group care to less than 10%. Some systems have even reduced their use of group care to under 5%. Lots of systems have closed emergency shelters completely. They don't use diagnostic centers and they don't use non-therapeutic group homes. Outstanding private providers, even residential providers, agree that, in fact, children should only be in residential treatment when there's a therapeutic need for it, and it should be used on a short-term basis, like an emergency room. And then children should be placed back in families. They should not be growing up in group care. Foster care is meant to be short-term as well. That was first identified in the Adoption Assistance and Child Welfare Act of 1980, and then reinforced by the Adoption and Safe Families Act of 1997. It's not meant for a place for children to grow up. We've seen systems that have focused on their long stayers, on getting those long stayers into permanent families, have done a lot of successful work in getting kids into permanence. And we've also seen from the data on survival statistics is that when you have a child in care for 3 years or more, their chances of permanence are almost nil. We give up on kids once they've been in care for 3 years, and that's what we can't allow to happen. All children have the right to permanence. Earlier in my career, I spent 14 years working with states, helping them maximize federal 4E revenues. Because of quirks in how 4E was developed and how it evolved from the AFDC program, the most important casework function, helping families deal with their problems, is not federally reimbursable through Title 4E. I know that seems amazing, but that is how the 4E program developed. In helping states maximize their 4E revenues, I helped them de-emphasize the important functions of child welfare and move on to emphasize such things as case management, assessing, referring to services, doing your paperwork, complying with laws. I helped them do what I think is the most damaging thing we've done to the system over the last 30 years, and that's de-emphasize the time we need to spend as caseworkers helping children and families. States that have been able to reduce their caseloads to manageable levels and have focused caseworkers on really doing the work, engaging families and working with them to help them deal with their issues, they have seen the improvements, not only in how caseworkers feel about their jobs, but in improving outcomes for children and families. Many jurisdictions have effectively and dramatically increased their use of relative caregivers. This not only lessens the trauma that children experience when they come into care, it's just better for kids altogether. Especially when a child, if you think of a child being taken from their families. This is especially possible when agencies actually support those relatives, not just place them, but support them, by providing them with stipends, by helping them deal with children's issues, behavioral problems, et cetera. And when agencies undertake family search and engagement to track down family members who may not be known to the system immediately, especially fathers. Those are the kinds of activities that can place children with family members safely and help them have long-term better outcomes. We've seen systems that treat foster parents, licensed foster parents, like they are the most important resource a child welfare agency has. And in fact, they are. When they are included in the planning for children, when they are treated with respect, when they are given the resources they need to care for children, when they are trained and provided with the skill sets and the supports they need to help children, we see disruptions go down. And disruptions in and of themselves are damaging to children in their short term and long term. We've also seen systems develop relationships between birth parents and foster parents. Those relationships we've seen have really helped improve reunification statistics, getting children back to their own families. Finally, we know there are successful ways to recruit foster parents, recruit them, train them, support them, even foster parents for teenagers and for sibling groups and for special needs kids. When we take the time and spend the energy to do this, we know we can get enough foster parents to meet the needs of the kids actually coming into care. Let's move this on. Our financing system, created in 1980, fails to recognize what we know about best practices today. It's an antiquated system created over 30 years ago based on the requirements of a long-gone welfare system. We can do better by using federal funds to strategically prioritize 21st century best practices. Just briefly, to look at the funding for child welfare, we know that about half of the money, a little over half of the money, is state and local, and the other half is federal. Of the federal share, about half of that is Title IV-E funds. The only other federal program dedicated to child welfare is the Title IV-B program, and as you can see, that only represents about 5% of the federal funding. TANF and the Social Services Block Grant are both critically important, but available for a wide range of other important needs as well. So child welfare agencies have to basically negotiate their share of that pie against other really significant and important uses as well. There are opportunities to promote what we know are the best practices through federal financing, specifically through the Title IV-E program. There is no good reason, no good practice reason, for children to be placed in shelters, in diagnostic centers, in non-therapeutic group homes, and residential treatment should always be short-term. We know that family support and engagement is important to improve outcomes for families, yet federal reimbursement is not available for caseworkers who spend time doing that. While federal reimbursement does exist for foster parent development, support, recruitment, agencies do not spend significant amounts of resources supporting this. They are not investing the resources necessary to maintain this function at adequate levels. Worker turnover is a problem. Training and supervision sometimes is inadequate. Federal reimbursement does not even include the training for child protective service workers at the very front door of the system. The people who make the decisions about who's in and who's out cannot be trained with federal reimbursement. It just doesn't make sense. Administrative burdens caused by eligibility systems based on 20th century income standards, they're not only overly burdensome, they just don't make sense. They're not related to the important work that needs to be done in child welfare. Finally, there is no dedicated funding for therapeutic services. Systems have to rely on their relationships with state Medicaid officials, and they generally don't prioritize the needs of a very small but high-need population. We believe that the best practices in child welfare, practices that we know work around placement decisions, timely permanence, family engagement, quality workforce, and foster parents, could be improved through strategic reimbursement rules. And to talk more about that, I'm going to turn it over to Patrick McCarthy.
Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning. It's really great to see so many familiar faces here. I'm going to try to make a little noise, and then after that, I'm going to kind of walk through our ideas, and actually it's important to say that these are ideas that we all stole from you guys. You've been developing these ideas over lots of different projects and reports over the years, and what we've tried to do is to weave them together so, as Tracey says, we do things that actually support families and support children and get the outcomes we want. I would like to say, just to frame this, though, I think Tracey did a wonderful job of talking about the reasons why we want to do this. But just for a moment, I'd like us to think about these kind of arcane and complicated financing ideas in the realm of what they would do to change practice as if the practice was going to be received by someone in our own family. I'd like us to use the My Family test as we go through this. Is this an idea that if my sister and her family were caught up in this system, that I'd say, yeah, that's what I would want for my family? Or do we tend to think about this as for some other families that we don't really have to think about? Left clicker? Okay. So I want to start with some basic assumptions. And these are things that actually some folks may argue with. They're worth having a debate about. But we just want to be clear with where we were starting. And the first idea was that actually federal financing can make a difference. We've seen in the use of federal incentives for adoption. We've seen it in incentives to close large institutions. We've seen it in the support for developing new information systems. All of these things were incentivized by federal funding. Now, people can say, look, workers are going to make their decisions based on their best practice ideas, and that's really true in most cases. But we have seen that, although it's not the only thing, federal financing can make a huge difference. It's not just about the money. When the federal financing system shifts, there's a whole new focus on the direction that that money takes folks, not just because of the money, but because the conversation starts to change. Second, we know that federal financing changes are not enough. Comprehensive reform of many of these systems is necessary. Constant innovation is necessary. Financing is not the only piece. However, it's awfully important. Third, we agree with many of our friends and colleagues and advocates who say many of the systems in this country are, in fact, underfunded. We know that. However, at the same time, we know that we can do better with the resources that we have. And in this particular moment in time, it is much more likely that we can engage a wide swath of interested folks in the question of how do we do better with what we have, and once we can do that, perhaps build the case for more resources as well. However, I really want to underscore this because this is critical. Child welfare cannot do the job of protecting children if we continue to take money out of the system. And this is a particular moment in time where we face that risk. So this is the time for all of us to come together and act, in my view, if we're going to protect the resources that child welfare systems need in order to protect children. Fourth, we know that systems need flexibility, but flexibility is not enough by itself. We need to build in flexible incentives into the system. Fifth, one of my favorite sayings is that a bad system will trump a good program any day of the week. Imagine if you worked for hours and hours and hours on a PowerPoint presentation and somehow or another, just at the point when you're about to present it, the computer system broke down. So I want to tell you that in many ways, the system that structures the programs that provide the practice to the folks on the ground, that provide the practice to your family, if you will, those systems will, if they're poorly designed and poorly funded, they will overwhelm anything that a program will do by itself. And most important, we can't afford to wait. The time to act is now. As I said a moment ago, some of the federal financing streams that you saw in that pie chart that Tracey put together, some of those federal financing streams are, in fact, at risk. And if we do nothing, we run the risk of those resources coming out of the child welfare system. So here are some sort of four headlines of where we think federal financing can actually make a difference in these four key areas. Again, think about your own family. The first issue is permanence, making sure that every child has a family for life. If this were your niece or your nephew, and they were in circumstances where it was not safe for them to be with one of your relatives, what would you want for that child? Would you want that child to be in foster care for years and to bounce from place to place to place, go in and out of group home, lose contact with her siblings, lose contact with her extended kin, have to change schools again and again and again and again? You would not want that for your child. So we need to align our financing systems. We need to align them with the sole goal of how do you get permanence, a lifelong family, a family for life, a forever family for every child. Second, we've got to take this opportunity to improve the foster care and kinship care systems so that if a child is removed from his or her own home, they in fact are well cared for while they're away from home. We've got to build a stronger workforce. Now imagine this, you get home late one night, you come home from work, and there's a knock on the door, and there before you, and nothing against 24-year-olds, I happen to like them a lot, but there before you is a 24-year-old young woman, very earnest, who says, we've received a call, and they say that you're not taking care of your kids, I need to come in and talk to you. Now imagine that knock on the door. You would want that 24-year-old, hopefully, to be the most experienced, competent, understanding, supportive, well-supported decision-maker you had ever met in your life, because at that moment, by God, you're terrified. Are we, in fact, supporting our frontline workforce? What can we do about our financing so it supports our frontline workforce, so when that knock comes on the door at your house, in fact, what you're hearing, what you're seeing, what you're getting involved in is a professional who's really supported to help your family. And finally, we've got to provide high-quality therapeutic and family support services. So I'm going to talk about each of these, and for each, a number of ideas of how federal financing can be tweaked, changed, reformed in a way that we believe will lead to better success on each of those. So let me start with the improving permanence and well-being for children. Again, each and every child deserves a family for life. We got four basic ideas on how we ought to achieve that. Number one, reduce the amount of time that children linger in foster care by simply saying that federal reimbursement will only pay for up to 36 months over the lifetime of a child. Second, eliminate federal reimbursement for shelter care. You heard from Tracey some of the reasons why shelter care can, in fact, lead to harm for kids, and that many systems have closed their shelter care systems successfully and replaced them with family-based emergency services. Third, eliminate federal reimbursement entirely for group care for any child under 13, and for children who need therapeutic services in a residential treatment center, limit the amount of time the child will spend in such a placement to a total of 12 months over the course of that child's life. And finally, support older youth who are preparing to transition to adulthood by helping them to build work habits and save as they go forward, learning from some of the lessons that the Jim Casey Youth Opportunities Initiative has shown around the country of providing individual development accounts, IDAs, for those young people so they can build assets, and when they move on in their life, they'll have assets for education, for housing, sometimes it's to buy a car so they can get to work, et cetera. Next big area, family foster care. You can't reduce our reliance on long-term care and congregate care and residential treatment unless you build a strong foster care system, stronger than we have today. Now, again, think about your own family. If one of your children, for whatever reason, had to be removed from home, and the choice was, so I'll tell you, Mr. McCarthy, you can either have your child go to a stranger or you can have your child go to your brother. Now, I'd have to choose the brother. But the fact is that we know that kids do better with kin. So we've got to do better in supporting kin. What we're proposing here is that because many of the kin who will take responsibility for a child on an emergency basis or a longer-term basis need resources to care for that child. And over half of the people who step up to the child welfare system and say, I will take in my kin member, don't get the same level of support as a foster care, a regular foster care, or what some people call stranger care, but what a regular foster care home would provide. So we are suggesting that kin ought to get those kinds of supports, and the barrier is often that they don't qualify for licensing. We're suggesting a basic tweak to the system that says that a kin member can get licensed for a particular child as long as the house is appropriate, the home is appropriate for that particular child, rather than that kin member, that aunt or uncle, having to meet a whole long list of other requirements that actually aren't relevant for that particular child. Might be relevant for a 2-year-old, but isn't really relevant for a 13-year-old, for example. So we're recommending a flexible licensing system that takes into account that you can license for a particular child. Next, if a child has to go into residential treatment, well, let me put it a different way. If your child had to go into residential treatment, would you say, let us know when he's done, and maybe we'll be there, but actually, yeah, we might find another kid we like better. We're going to take that kid in. You wouldn't do that, right? You'd say, no matter what happens, Johnny, we're going to come and visit you. We're going to be there for you, and when you're done this residential treatment, you're coming home. You're coming home to us. Right now, foster parents often can't afford to do that. If a foster home has a child in care who has to go into residential treatment, their funding ends at that point. We are suggesting that foster parents be eligible to continue to receive support so that they'll be able to continue to be involved with that young person during what hopefully is a short period of time in residential treatment so they can return home to that foster family. Next, we need to invest much more in both recruiting and supporting foster parents. We need to think about our foster parents and our kinship parents, but our foster parents as very much part of the front line. In fact, they're the ones who are going to be reacting and responding when a child has a trigger around a post-traumatic stress kind of reaction, or when some of the stresses that they've experienced start showing up in the child's behavior. So we've got to figure out ways to support those foster parents. What we are proposing here is that we make foster parent workers, that is the workers who support foster parents, eligible for reimbursement, which they are not now, so that you'd have workers who specialize in training and supporting and being able to drive out when somebody says, I'm about to move this kid out of my house because he's driving me crazy. Hang on, Mrs. Jones, I'll be there in 5 minutes, is what we need. And so we're suggesting that federal funds ought to be reimbursing that. And finally, we ought to be encouraging more foster parents, more people to become foster parents. Lots of ways to do that. There is now a $1,000 tax credit for foster parents. We're proposing that that be increased to $5,000 for those foster parents who are willing to take older youth, sibling groups, and special needs youth. Next, let's get to the front line, that person knocking on your door. We've got a number of suggestions here. Right now, if you go back to school for your social work degree and you take out a loan, I happen to have a daughter who did that, and she took out a loan, and it's great, but she has, and she got a job, also great, but she has to work for 10 years as a social worker in order to sort of work off the forgiveness for that loan. We're suggesting that be reduced to 4 years. I didn't put that in there, I promise you. No conflict of interest here, but it would be great because she's like 2 years in and 4 years would be great. Right now, we, as Tracey said, the federal system reimburses for essentially administrative tasks that social work staff might provide. They don't reimburse for the kinds of work of truly engaging the family and assessing the family, looking at risks and strengths and working with the families and others to make a good decision. We're proposing that federal dollars ought to reimburse those kinds of activities, and they also ought to reimburse the cost of training for the front end. Again, that knock on the door. The child protective front door system is one of the most critical pieces of our entire child welfare system. That's where the decisions first get made. We need to have very well-trained people making those decisions. Right now, federal dollars do not reimburse that kind of training. And this is on the greatest hits. I think this goes back to well before the Pew Commission, but has been an issue for many, many years, which is eliminating the look back, the so-called look back. Many folks in this room realize that the process of determining whether or not a particular individual child is eligible for his or her care to be reimbursed under 4E, the eligibility process looks back to what that child's eligibility would have been for AFDC, which, as we all know, was done away with in 1996. So you can't make this stuff up, right? The trouble is, because that way of doing things is kind of baked into the system, everybody's afraid to touch it because there'll be winners and losers, and some states do very, very well at this eligibility determination, and they get up to, like, what's the percentage, Tracey, with 30-40%, maybe even higher, 50% in some states. And other states are at like 22%, right? So the worry is, well, gee, if you change that, you know, you're gonna have winners and losers. We know that. There's no easy answer, there's no perfect answer, but guys, it's 2013 and counting. If we continue to use the look back every year, money is being leached out of the system. We've got to step up and deal with this. And our proposal simply is this. We say we will eliminate the look back. All children in care will be eligible. We'll reduce the federal match rate so the net amount of federal dollars remains the same. However, we provide states with a 3-year warning, so we gradually come into it and basically say, you've got 3 years to basically figure out your what your eligibility ought to be, and that's going to be the formula that's going to drive this system. Now, again, that is not a perfect idea, but we're dealing with a very, very tough and seemingly intractable problem that we keep ignoring and ignoring and ignoring. We cannot let another decade go by with this system in place. So there may be other ideas out there. Happy to hear them, but that's what we would recommend at this point. Finally, funding social and therapeutic services. Now, clearly, Medicaid is the logical and appropriate source for funding for most of the clinical services that deal with the most common child welfare problems, and we all know what they are. Substance abuse of parent or child, mental health problems of parent or child, behavioral problems of child. For the moment, we'll put aside housing. But the clinical needs are one of those three things, probably in 80% of the families where there's a clinical problem. Medicaid is structured in such a way that we ought to be able to use those funds in order to pay for the services that are needed to deal with the family's issues. And in fact, recently the feds came out with really good guidelines on how Medicaid can be used to support evidence-based practice. However, we believe that in order to really move the needle on this at the state level, which is really where the rubber meets the road, we've got to provide really high quality technical assistance, because this is complicated stuff. And we would propose that the feds require a joint child welfare Medicaid plan, because otherwise the child welfare population, frankly, is just too small for the Medicaid directors to pay that much attention to it. When you look at the cost of senior care, for example, the cost of child welfare care seems small. But these are very high needs children, very high needs families. If we can convince states to do a joint planning process between Medicaid and child welfare. And I'm here to tell you that the Casey Foundation is happy to support that in any way that we can. And if we provide technical assistance to states so they get it right, we're going to make a huge difference in the resources available for therapeutic and therapeutic services. Now, Tracey showed you the chart, the pie chart, that had all the different federal funds and how they're allocated. That was for the country as a whole. If you look at each individual state, you'll find that each individual state has cobbled together, you know, a little bit of TANF, some SSBG, 4B, 4E. It's a very complicated kind of a system, and it's all cobbled together. The bottom line, though, is that those funds, the funds that are now used, the 4B, the Social Services Block Grant, the TANF funds, those are the funds that are really being used to support families, keep families together in ways that 4E historically has not been allowed to do. We have got to protect those funds in the midst of all the conversations going on in Washington right now about the future of the budget. These are essentially small amounts of money when you look at the big picture, but for the child welfare system, if you take out SSBG funding, if you take out TANF funding, you're going to have a huge hole in many, many states' budgets. Now, this is really important. Everything I just said was really important, but this is really, really important. If you just look at the savings side of things and say, ah, we can save money in child welfare if we just put in place reductions in how long you can pay for a kid in care and how long they can stay in residential treatment, et cetera, we can save a lot of money. That would be a disaster. These things are all wrapped together. We've seen in other kinds of systems, such as the mental health system, that simply cutting down on the institutional care, which was a good thing, doesn't get us to a good mental health system. It just helps us do less harm, but it does not get us to a good mental health system. If all we do is reduce our investments in the deep end that I talked about a moment ago without reinvesting in the kinds of direct services and supports that families need, children will be harmed. If all we do is cut the budget because we say, oh, here's some easy places to do it, children will be harmed. And we ought to be holding ourselves accountable for it. So if we limit reimbursement for foster care, we can get some savings. If we eliminate reimbursement for some of the bad practices we talked about, if we can reduce administrative overhead, and we didn't even talk about all the money it costs to do all that eligibility, reduce administrative overhead, and if we reinvest those savings in people, we reinvest in the foster parents, we reinvest in the frontline practice folks, we reinvest in the young people themselves who are making transitions to adulthood, then we're going to be successful. If all we do is focus on the savings, we're not going to be successful. This is not an a la carte kind of menu, pick and choose what you want. Finally, we know that the ideas that we're presenting today have lots of limitations and therefore lots of opportunities to be made stronger. We know that we started with a list of assumptions, and it's important to keep in mind what those assumptions are. We ought to pressure test those assumptions. Again, we know that financial incentives alone are not going to drive the kind of practice improvement that we need. We've actually, in this presentation and in all the work that Tracey and her team and Rob and lots of folks have done over the last numbers of months, we've focused actually on the reforms that we know the most about, you know, trying to stick to our business, right? But we know there's lots of other things that other folks know more about that ought to be in this conversation. For example, around early intervention to prevent child abuse or neglect, family courts, tribal administrations, adoption recruitment, and post-adoption recruitment. Not that these are things we know nothing about, but we're not as experienced in helping states in all of those areas as some other folks in this room are. So we know that's important. Another obvious limitation, I understand there's been some unpleasantness recently in D.C., but it's all behind us now. We really know that the time to act is now. It is a very uncertain and volatile political environment. That's actually not a reason to say, well, let's wait a while. It's bound to get better. I actually don't think that's true. And in fact, ideas like this, in my view, might be a way to help it get better, because we all care about children. We can find bipartisan consensus on many of these kinds of ideas. Let's find places where we can work together and move the ball. So I'm going to invite all of you to join the conversation. I'm going to start by introducing Gary Stangler to you, who will then introduce what is really a terrific panel that we have. Many of the folks in this room know Gary well. You know he's been a constant advocate for children and youth throughout a long and really inspirational and impressive career. Gary was a cabinet secretary in the state of Missouri for 12 years, which meant he served under both Republican and, oh, this is great. So now Gary's going to talk. You're going to hand out the stuff so people can look at it while Gary talks. That's great. But Gary survived both a Republican and a Democrat administration. He was a member of the Pew Commission on Child Welfare Financing, and he is now the president and chief executive officer of the Jim Casey Youth Opportunities Initiative. That means that over the course of his career, he's experienced most of the challenges that we've been talking about today. He's one of the smartest folks in the country on this issue. So I'm going to turn it over to Gary to give some of his reactions and to introduce our terrific panel. And I'm assuming the panel should come up now, Gary. Yeah.
Well, good morning again. Tracey started off by confessing her role in promoting a system that damaged the way we work with families. So I am moved to confess that I was one of the state directors that hired her to do that. And that was really the beginning of a journey. And I was thinking last night, so when did the fight start to take place? And it was in a small hotel room at then APWA meeting. It may even have been this hotel or one very nearby, but I listened to this researcher named Ron Haskins present a proposal for block granting 4E and demonstrating the trajectory of spending. Very prescient, because he told us then, this is in the early 90s, what was going to happen with 4E eventually with the look-back provision, et cetera. And so it began. Then he moved on to the Hill to actually make it happen. I moved on to be the chair of the National Council of Human Services Administrators through the TANF debate, the passage of TANF, and then a debate over block granting, the entitlement in 4E, in which the entitlement narrowly prevailed. But it started an impasse that has existed ever since. And so for now, the past almost 20 years, we've been bouncing back and forth between block grant and keep the entitlement, but how do you make the entitlement work? How do you get flexibility as a strategy, not a goal? How can we make this work? And it's been entirely frustrating. And when the Pew Commission on Children and Foster Care came along, Judge Bill Thorne and I were privileged to serve on that, and we spent a good 2 years of intense study and research and talking to experts and people in the field and came up with not much different than that dynamic. And depending on the day, if you asked me if I wanted a block grant, well, if I'm state director, sure. But if that other guy is, no, then no block grant. So we've been stuck here, and it is my fervent hope that the ideas presented here that Patrick has put forth will break through this debate. I'm not just fervently hopeful. I'm really optimistic that we're ready, finally, to break out of this stalemate and push this agenda, because it is an urgent situation. And yes, I know things are a little tense in Washington, but sometimes that's when you can really get something done. So I urge you to take that to heart. I've got an amazing panel here. They are an array of diverse perspectives, and let me assure you, very strong passions and deep convictions about these issues. And I'm going to start with my right, Andre West, a foster parent trainer from Tampa, Florida. Bill Thorne, judge recently retired from the Utah Court of Appeals, whom I've known for many years. He's been an advocate on these issues. Jarrell Melendez from New York City, youth who spent time in the system and is now spending his time trying to make that into a better system. Anne Marie Ambrose, the Commissioner of Social Services in Philadelphia. And Jeremy Cohamben, whom I just met last night from Children's Village in New York, and I wish I'd met him 20 years ago. You have a list of their bios. I'm not going to go into that. We're going to go right into what I hope is a conversation where they don't just answer questions from a moderator, but they have a discussion among themselves. We'll save a little bit of time for questions from the audience. But I'm going to kick it off just by sort of generally saying, Patrick outlined a number of areas of improvement that we needed in terms of permanent family connections, workforce improvements, improvements to family foster care, reduction of congregate care, et cetera. And I guess I'm just going to ask first, what ideas resonated most with you? Can you separate the priority? Or where do we begin? And what does this inspire in you? And I'm going to start on the far end with Jeremy, if you don't mind, Jeremy.
Glad to. Good morning. I think the two things that resonate most strongly with me, and they're connected, is the use of residential care and the appropriate use of residential care, and building a network of families so that kids can actually enjoy a family rather than a system solution, which is institutional care.
I think for me, the vision that Tracey and Patrick laid out actually makes sense from the perspective of kids and families instead of from the perspective of the professionals involved in the lives of kids and families. And that's critically essential to actually use the voices of youth and use the voices of families in doing anything that we do on behalf of them in the child welfare system. And so those policies that have been recommended today are exciting and they're right. They're a little scary, and there's some challenges involved in trying to change massive culture. And I think it's great that we have a judge on the panel, because I think the court can be critically important as a support or a barrier to trying to implement some of those policies.
Morning. The thing that really sticked out listening to the panel and the PowerPoint earlier was the permanency piece. As a product of the child welfare system, I was in care from 5 to 18, and I was in a number of different kinships and non-foster placements, well, I should say foster family placements. And the permanency piece is really crucial, like providing that support and encouragement and you know, having a young person as I got older from 5 to adolescent age, it was crucial to really provide that resource and have that permanency goal and vision and support. So the permanency is what really jumped out at me.
The thing that made the most difference to me is that we say we know children do better in families, yet we support a system that removes them from their families and then cuts them off from their families. And then we prevent the workers from doing work with the families that will help them go home. I mean, somehow we need to rethink that, because budgets really are moral documents. We ought to be supporting the things we know work instead of just supporting a system.
the thing that resonated most with me was the training that we're talking about, you know, and how we look at foster parents and how we approach that particular situation with foster parents. How we need to be looking for parents, not placements, or places. We need to be looking for parents and not places. The professional way in which we train foster parents, they should be a respected profession. It takes a community to raise a child. And we all need to have that holistic approach that foster parents are an integral part of what happens with that child's life, because we're with the child 24/7. We need to be involved with every aspect of that child's life, as far as the administrative side of it, staffings, being a part of the court hearings. And there needs to be funding to assist the foster parent to get the training they need to deal with the trauma-sensitive children that are in the system of care.
I want to add to that is, what we do now with foster parents is we treat them like a hotel room. There's a space, we'll put a child in there. As long as the child's not hurt there, we don't care really what happens. Instead, what we need to do would be building those relationships so that ideally, if the child goes home, those foster parents are still a part of that child's life. We've created a relationship for that child that they can fall back on if they should ever need it. I mean, you don't have to have blood relationships to care about somebody and to say, I'm a part of your life. If you ever need me, I'm there. We ought to be supporting those foster parents so that it's not a dichotomy of choosing natural family or foster family. Ideally, we'd be working with both, and they'd be working as a team along with the youth to decide, how do we fix this? What's our best route? Instead of just, it's a hotel room and we'll put somebody in there.
Also, to piggyback on what the judge is talking about, as well as just placing a child in the state of Florida, we recognize the need for reform. And by default, we received Carol Schofer, a lawyer out of San Francisco, that was a part of a program that began to change the culture on how we deal with foster children in the system of care. How do we begin to address some of the needs that across the country that make up this conglomerate of all the people and their ideas? How do we begin to start implementing some of those programs? That program is called QPI, and it's active in four states right now. And there's about four counties throughout America that have adopted the concept. And it brings everyone to the table as a result of children. It also tells the story that the brand and how we look at foster parents need to, a change of image. They're no more longer glorified babysitters. They're professionals. There should be respected professionals in their areas and know their role exactly how it applies. And there are certain areas they don't need to cross over into, but at the same time, they need to be in communication, and the system is complex with a lot of different moving parts. And how do we involve the foster parent in the court hearings, permanency, staffings, all of those things, their face needs to be in there. And so the way we do business in the system of care has been a long overdue overhaul. And I'm excited to be a part of this panel that's implementing those things. And we need people to open their hearts and begin to start looking at these issues.
You know, it's easy for members of the choir here to nod and say, yes, all that is true. But if it was this easy, we would have done it by now. One of the most provocative pieces here, we believe, is the limitation of congregate care, and in fact, the elimination of it for children under 13. Kids should be raised in families. I believe there's no substitute for a family. But Jeremy, I'm not sure all private agencies are going to applaud this. Annie, I'm not sure the public agencies are going to embrace this right out of the chute, and so on and so forth. So let's get down to the harder issues, as Andre said. So how do we make it work?
So I'll take a shot at it, since Children's Village created residential care as we know it in the 1800s, and we're still a large provider of residential care. But let me start by saying, you know, I don't want to pretend that this is about all children, right? That's not true. This is about, you only come into foster care 98% of the time if you're poor, and then you really hit the jackpot if you're poor and of color. End of story. So this is not, none of our children in this room, I guess, would ever come into foster care. I know my Nicholas, Jordan, and Abigail wouldn't end up in this system. This is a system that disproportionately targets people who are poor, and now today, people who are poor and of color. So I just want to get that out there. So there's a real social justice implication here that we want to talk about. If you come into residential care, the history of residential care has been we will create a place for you that's far better than your poor family and your poor neighborhood. That's the story. That's a narrative of residential care. And, you know, many of you in this room probably think that residential care is the place you go to get residential treatment, and the word treatment implies mental health, right? Come on, give me a couple of nods. You know that. That's the implication. Well, that's nonsense. 70% of the kids that come to Children's Village, and we have the data, and this is true across the country, are not mentally ill by DSM standards. So they're not what we call persistent and chronic. They're situational. And the mental illness is the lack of belonging. They've been ripped away from families, ripped away from communities. They are really mad at all of us and incredibly scared and afraid for their future. And so they exhibit symptoms that we then label as mentally ill. Less than 30% of the kids in the system are serious and persistent mental illness. Those are huge numbers. You factor in then to that the reality that across the United States, 80% of the kids that come into our system are there because of neglect, not because of abuse. I know the horrific stories of abuse are what catches our eye, and so you would assume that the kids in residential care are there because they were taken from these terrible, terrible people that were out to kill them. Well, that's not true either. 80% of the kids that come into residential care were removed on petitions of neglect, and we still keep them away from their families. And then finally, you look at the number of kids aging out. At least in New York, over 60% of the kids aging out this year will have spent their last couple years in residential care or in some kind of residential care. Well, most of them, well, I'll put it this way, the lucky few out of that aging out group will actually go back to the same families that we removed them from. That's the lucky group. The unlucky ones will hit our shelters, will hit our streets, will end up in jail, will end up in psychiatric hospitals, will be long-term system dependent at terrible costs. I mean, talk about the cost implications here to society and to our bottom lines. So for us to think of residential care as a destination service is kind of crazy. And I can tell you, as being the organization that started this story, it's taken us about 140 years to figure this out, but we're pretty convinced that that was the wrong place to be.
I think from my perspective, we have providers like Jeremy who get it and understand that the world is going to change in a big way for them, and they'll be successful as parts of my system, and there are others who don't. So I want to say a couple of things. One is, if we could have designed a crazier system, we wouldn't want to do that. I mean, the things that I have to do as a child welfare administrator are really shameful at times. So, you know, we heard Tracey talk about the bureaucracy and the funding that we put towards administrative services and contracts to make sure that we can capture federal dollars. And the other piece of that is the things that we do to kids. And it's mostly older kids because, you know, the little kids, those are the hard cases, right? Your workers are really struggling to keep them safe. And with the older kids, they can fool themselves. The workers can fool themselves into thinking that older kids are safe if they're in a place. And so this issue of place is important. And we don't think about permanency. And so we really have to have a relentless urgency around what's happening from the kid's perspective. So what Patrick said about it being a member of your family, just think about it from you being the kid. And so we in Philadelphia, we use shelter care a lot. So Annie E. Casey came, my friend Chris Bean came and did an assessment of our system, and it's shameful, some of the things that we're doing, and we have to change them. I also want to be cautious, though, because, you know, when I came into our system, we had about 31% of our kids in congregate care. This was in 2007. We're now at 20%, but the national average is 14%. We are really lucky to be one of the recipients of the Child Welfare Demonstration Project grants from the Administration of Children and Families. And one of our goals is to continue to reduce the number of kids in Philadelphia in congregate care by 30%. But that's really tricky. And we're in the midst of of that transformation right now. And in order to do that successfully, you have to create the options. And so recruitment of foster parents for older youth, making sure that they have the right training, making sure that they have the right services necessary. And I'm fortunate in Philadelphia to have a behavioral health leader who's a partner in this. And so she's talking about having this lifeline 24/7 when a foster parent's in trouble and a youth is experiencing crisis because of the trauma that they've experienced and all the behaviors that come with that. Who is that lifeline that foster parent's going to be able to call in the middle of the night to stabilize that situation and make sure that we can make it into a permanent situation? So this is really complicated stuff, and I think the caution I have is there's lots of other factors that bear on all these great policies that have been discussed today. And so I think we just need to be careful about making sure that the flexibility is available, which is something that the waiver provides us with, and we're committed to doing all of the things that Patrick and Tracey talked about. But there might be somebody later who comes after me who doesn't have those same commitments. And I just think you have to be really, really careful about how you build the collaborations necessary to be successful in implementing the things that we're talking about here. So I'm committed to reducing the use of shelter in Philadelphia, and I'd love to be New York City and, you know, only have one shelter in the city and limit the stay to 5 days, and that's the goal that we have. We've already cut 3 of our shelters in the short time that we've been working with Casey, but that's a process that has made the advocates and the courts and everybody else a little crazy and insane. And so I think it's about how you do all of these things in a planful way, and building the right options and having the right supports are really critical to reducing the number of kids that we have in congregate care. It's absolutely the right thing, and when you hear it from the voices of the kids, you know, I'm really lucky in Philadelphia to have a group of kids who've been through the system called Youth Fostering Change, and they come and meet with me, and they tell me all the great things that I should be doing differently about the system to help the next kids who come next. And it's heartbreaking when you ask them, you know, what could we have done different? And what they say invariably is, you could have helped my mom. It's as simple as that. You know, like when you were 5, and I don't know your situation, so I don't want to generalize too much, but for many of these kids, if we would have, at the front door, had the right workers with the right training, putting in the right supports, we wouldn't be where we are now.
But Judge Thorne, are the judges going to stand by and watch this?
Well, we need to convince judges first that the system is not perfect. Because it's easy for them to go home at night and sleep, validating any recommendation that's made to them. That, well, this is what the professionals tell me. I didn't go to social work school. I'm not a psychologist. I'm not a child developmental person. I'm just going to do what the professionals say. And instead, we need to get judges to start to ask questions. If we recognize that institutional care is not good, when the worker comes in and makes that recommendation, if they know the judge is going to have 15 minutes, half hour dialogue with them about why is this really necessary? What options have you looked at? What's the goal of this? How do we know when we succeed and that child can leave that kind of care? When you have those kinds of discussions, pretty soon people start to self-select and say, it's easier for me just to do the work than it is to get this judge to sign off on this placement so I can put the kid here and move on to something else. But if you really want to see what institutional care does to a community, take a look at the Indian boarding schools and what they have done to the Indian communities. For 130 years, they have taken children away from their families with the promise of a new and better life. We're going to get you out of poverty. We're going to get you out of those terrible situations. We're going to put you someplace better. And now we have families who don't know how to be parents anymore because they've never been parented. And their grandparents don't know because they weren't parented. If you want to see what the impact is, take a look at those and then ask yourself, do you want that for your children? I don't think so. I think we need to start to get the judges to start asking, is this going to heal? Not just, is this a placement? We should be having institutions that create healing and not just shelter.
Jarrell, you've heard from the private agency that runs the programs, the state is going to decide or make recommendations to the judges who are going to make a decision. Meanwhile, there you are, watching all three of these actors do what they do. What can you say about who asked you what you wanted when you were going through
this? Well, I would say this. It's definitely important and crucial to really ask the young people and involve the young person. Don't just talk about it like it's a case number. As a professional nowadays, I also have cases, and I know there's deadlines and there's notes to write and there's different tasks, but I'm always constantly remembering that it's very crucial to ask the young people exactly what do they want? What does that look like? What services do they feel are working? What community resources? I really feel like young people are the untapped resource. No one really talks and figure out what's working, because they will tell you. And usually the community and the stuff that they will share is something outside the box. We have kind of go-to resources and services that we feel are working, and they usually bring a fresh set of eyes and new ideas. And also, just listening to everyone up here, I strongly agree with all of the points with the training. Training is so crucial. Like, I can honestly say, I knew my work is at 5. I seen them. Although it was a turnover, it wasn't the same from 5 to 10, I got to see them. As I got older, oh, they would call. Hey, how is everything? Okay, everything's good. Okay, good. And that's really not what it should be. It should be the same, whether you're 5 or 13 in care. It really should be consistent, and I feel that with getting that consistency will involve training and the support of the frontline staff and all that's involved.
Before I go to Andre, Annie is chomping here.
Yeah, I
here.
Just, Jarrell, thank you for saying something about the workers, because I think this idea of not reimbursing them for the thing that's most important is crazy. So we started team decision making a while ago, and it is so critical to be able to engage young people. So for all of our decision making conferences for young people 13 and older, they will be participants in those meetings. But we really need to make sure that our staff have the time to do the work that brought them to this profession in the first place, not filling out forms, not compliance driven, but engaging families and youth in ways that are going to actually help their experience. And I think our workforce is demoralized now because of the way that the system has morphed into being compliance driven instead of about relationships, which is really at the heart of the work that we do.
All right, Andre, we've heard we have a demoralized system. We have a system that relies too much on group care. You're the foster parent trainee and a foster parent yourself. Can we do this? Are there enough families out there? Even if we have the best training in the world, will there be families for all these young people?
Absolutely. There are abundance of families out there. I don't know how many of you are familiar with the Davion story coming out of my area, out of Hillsborough County area and St. Pete area in Florida. Davion had a story where he went to the church, and he basically said, I just need someone to love me. I don't care what color they are. I don't care, you know, what the situation. Just love me for who I am. And that resonated with me, because everything the panel here is talking about, Annie talked about things happening on the front end. The proposal talks about us dealing with, you know, talking more funding for CPIs as far as, you know, the training, and they're the first line of defense with these children. He just spoke from a foster parent perspective about where the child needs to be involved with everything that happens with that child. We failed that child. That child was in the system of care from 5 years old to 15 and needed a home, needed a placement, needed someone just to love him. But he's the story across America. This is happening in many of our cities. It's not new. He was bold enough to stand up in front of a congregation and articulate his feelings and be precise and targeted. It went viral. We're getting phone calls. We are over 1,000 now, easy. We had to pick up and make a whole new phone system in order to accommodate. We weren't equipped for that in Hillsborough County and Pinellas County. All of a sudden, we have to do all these things to accommodate Davion. And it's exciting. It's exciting because the families are there. They're there, whether by mistake or by, you know, default or whatever it might be. If we, when once those people come, those 1,000 come, if we don't have a system that's successful the able to recruit those foster parents and bring those adoptive parents in, it goes by the wayside. So therefore, we need to be prepared. The CPIs need more training because we've attracted people in high-level government wanting to adopt Davion. Even before Davion, the way that we've changed the culture in our area, we've received a lot of military, high-ranking. But because of the way the laws are written right now, and there's a need for a change in those laws, these men, they have such high level of clearance, but the level of clearance that we have as being a foster parent trumps it. How can that happen in a system of care? So I've lost these high-ranking officials in my classes. They get to a certain point and say, wow, this could happen to my career? No, thank you. So why should they be penalized for a heart? They're serving the country. They're keeping all of us safe, but yet they can't come back and foster a child? There's a problem.
Can I also just say, sometimes our systems haven't done enough to recruit foster parents for older youth, and that's my system. But last night, we did a phone bank on ABC6 for 2.5 hours. We had 165 people call in wanting to be foster parents for older youth. And so I think the more we talk about it, the better we'll get at really seeking out the right people and trying to create flexible opportunities for them to do the right thing by our kids.
So I want to say something about foster parents. Sorry, Judge Thorne. am I going to jail now?
we'll talk.
you know, I when you hear the suggestions and the recommendations that have been made today, I mean, you see the tax credits and some of that conversation. That's real, but. When we focus on getting older kids homes, the one things foster parents ask us for, I want to just reiterate what Patrick said, will you be there for me when something goes wrong? You know, I know being a foster parent for a teenager isn't easy, I get that, but will you be there to make sure that you help me through this? And creating a system of simply being there has been a big part of our success in getting foster parents to the table and making sure that they stay through and stay committed to teenagers. So, and that's not something that I think requires federal intervention. That's something we can do at the local level. Just be there.
To build on what Jeremy was talking about, if we can't get kids back to the home they came from, relatives ought to be the next option. And that means we ought to support them. I can't tell you the times that I've seen a worker come in and say, well, grandma's not an option. Well, why? She's old. She's going to die soon. Well, if a child gets 5 good years from a grandparent, that's wonderful compared to a stranger. We need to rethink this. The kids need the connections. So if they can't have kin, then we need quality foster homes, and that means supporting them. It means, again, not treating them as fungible deliverables where you have to pass this exam and we'll put somebody with you, but to give them a voice and to give the kids a voice in those connections, because we want a relationship out of that. We don't want just a bed and some meals. We want somebody who can take time away from their work, away from their other things, because we support them adequately. They can go to the PTA meetings. They can go to the parent-teacher conferences. They can go to the doctor's visits, just as they would for their own kids, and have that relationship. And if we don't support them, then, yeah, kids are going to blow through placements, and we're going to have institutions as the last options. But It just makes no sense to me. I mean, it's like those old Fram oil filter commercials. Pay me now or pay me later. We ought to be supporting the families first. We ought to be supporting the people who are willing to open their homes and their hearts. And all you have to do is look at, I'm seeing second, third, fourth generation kids. which means we removed them fine that first time, but we didn't do very good at healing them. We didn't prepare them to become parents in their own right, and their children and their grandchildren are in the system. I mean, what do we need to say? The layman's definition of insanity, you do the same thing over and over and expect a different result? Well, if we didn't do a good job healing their parents and their grandparents, we ought to be thinking about how to form those relationships, how to give kids a voice and engage them, how to engage the community. Because doing it the same old way isn't working. We may have kept them safe till they were 18. But Jeremy told you what it was like after they turned 18. And all you have to do is look at their kids to see that we haven't healed and we haven't made things better. We've just kicked the can down the road, just like some people do with budgets.
Jarrell,
I just wanted to highlight and point out that, you know, growing up in the foster care system, what I do definitely want to mention, although I personally never had any foster care experience with the group home, I never was in one. However, growing up, I had peers that was, you know, when I went to the agency, I would hear a number of my peers say, oh my God, my group home, the staff turnover and the rules are crazy. You're so lucky to be in a foster care. Like, at least you have someone that's consistent. It's the same individual. It's a foster parent, but you have that relationship. You know, the judge was saying the relationship is so crucial. And I can definitely tell you, you know, I graduated high school and I did all of those things because I had that same individual pushing me, which was my maternal grandmother. At 5, I was removed from my maternal grandmother. At 18, I was adopted by my maternal grandmother. So in my case, if you would have gave the support and encouragement, I would not have had to do the 360 with all them other placements. I could have probably got adopted at 86 instead of 18. So it's really, it's crucial to get that support, that encouragement, and working with the communities and putting all of those services in line. And group homes should never, ever be an option, in my opinion, because I can tell you, there's nobody that I ever met that had firsthand experience. I'm thinking of my peers that said, oh, I love my group home. I haven't met one yet, so I don't think it should be an option.
Just recently, you just talked about, you know, children aging out of the system of care. The two boys that I adopted, that transition, a lot of states have went to where they've extended the amount of time the children can stay in the system of care to 21, which I think is a good start. Because one of the biggest flaws that I feel in the system of care, we have children in a captured environment. We're thinking about getting children out of the foster homes, but while they're there, what skills are we preparing these children for? What things are we really doing to help them for life? I did a lot of things myself as a parent, but even with everything I tried to do for the boys that I still have challenges with, they're in the recycle mode. They're out, they're back. They're out, they're back in my home. Because they're still, it's because a lot of spaces have been missed. They've been through so much trauma. There are gaps of life that they just miss, and the basic skills that we take for granted that we get up and do every morning, they don't possess. So then if we just excuse them at 18 and say, okay, you know, your 18 years are over with, here's life. Then I turn around and I see some of those same young men in the jail that I minister to that still don't know who their parents are. What are we doing? We have to really take a serious look at our system and what we're breeding. And I don't think it takes a whole lot of money, but it's gonna take a change of heart, a change of direction. You've heard from the panel the things that we are very crucial and you know, passionate about with these children. We're in the grassroots levels. We work with these children. We work with the families. We work within a system that really has a lot of challenges, and we need a lot of people to get on board about the change that needs to take place now, not tomorrow. Because by the time we leave this room, I would hate to even tell you the statistics of what has happened to children just in the little town we've been in here meeting.
Jeremy, Andre has talked about foster parents as professionals. We've talked about them as the families. Are we creating conflict there? And how is the workforce, so if they're part of the workforce, then how is this going to reconcile with our own workers and private agencies and public agencies? How do we make this work?
So I think we make this work slowly, right? There's no quick fix here. We have to go out and create a strong foster parent community to do all the things we want to do, and that's going to take us time. Because right now, and this is not a value judgment, it just seems to be that our foster parents are often the same foster parents that go from agency to agency. We need to broaden that net and bring in a lot more foster parents that are not simply willing to do this work, but also bring a set of resources so that they can work at different levels with different kids. So a 17-year-old that is thinking, that has all the qualifications to go to college one day, would do best with foster parents that have time to focus on college applications and all the things that I did with my son as he was preparing to go to college. That's important because that's what families do. I'm not saying that every young person needs to go to college, but yeah, let's at least kind of try to measure up to the national statistics and make sure that kids in foster care have those same levels of placement in college. So I think the workforce will adjust as we begin to make system changes to value foster parents as a group that's able to do some of the things that we currently think can only be done in residential or worse, in hospitals. And I think we can win that battle. I do want to say a couple things, though, Gary. I mean, I don't want to bash residential here because residential has a place. We need to make sure it's right-sized to that place because I'd rather a kid have a safe bed in a good residential facility than be on the street, than couch surf, than trade sex for shelter or be in jail. And that happens way too often. So we need to make absolutely sure we have the right kind of residential system. And then I would also, going back to what you said, Andre, about the challenges of being a foster parent. I mean, the reason you see those same children in your home and then later in jail is because I think by creating long-term dependency in foster care, we kind of tell kids, hey, look, we took you away from your families, and now we as big government, we have a solution for your life. And that's absolutely not true, right? So kids, the only other solution when you leave foster care that's government-funded is either a shelter, homeless shelter, or prison. That's it. And so by creating this kind of sense of entitlement that somebody is going to take care of me, we let down our kids in a big way. And so I don't have a lot of Jarrell is a great example. We all have a few of them. We just don't have enough, right? 80% of our kids should be like Jarrell, not 20%.
Yeah, I just wanted to make a little point about this differential licensing. So in Philadelphia, we actually do a pretty good job of keeping kids with kin, but we could do a far better job if we would not have sort of these middle-class values and judgments about the families that we serve. In Philadelphia, about 40% of our kids live in poverty, and therefore their families live in poverty. And so with our older youth, we run into challenges in the licensing requirements for those kinship homes. And, you know, if the outlets aren't exactly right and there's some wiring hanging down from the ceiling, that home might not be licensed. But a home for a 2-year-old is very different than a home for a 16-year-old. And so I think there needs to be this flexibility that Patrick talked about when we look at licensing, particularly for kin homes. And we need to get away from the culture of middle class values are great for every kid. That's really not true. A loving family that they live in that might be poor is better than shipping them to Montgomery County for a foster care situation when that family is willing and able to take care of them absent the licensing issues.
I'm going to transition in a minute to the audience being able to participate here, but one last point. A lot of the things I've heard today about the urgency, about what we need to do for kids and families, we've been saying for a long time. And so what is it? Is it possible? We recognize the urgency. There's a little tension in Washington. We know that. But is it possible? What's different? Do we have the knowledge now to lower one part of the system and raise up another and improve what needs to be done? Can it be done, Jeremy? Can we do it now?
I hope so. I mean, we don't want to waste our time talking about this on panels, do we? We really want to go out and actually do the work. I think we can. I think You know, if we talk about poverty, if we talk about the injustice of what's happening to poor people, if we can finally start talking about the implications of race and color, and this is national, right? This is not just a New York City system. I think we can find the balance, because that's what we do as a nation. We are really good at fixing problems, right? We're a nation that gets things done. So we can fix this problem. We need to just, you know, I'll tell you, when you go back to your communities, do what I often do in New York with my staff. We track 55 communities in New York City. Over 60% of our kids in the child welfare system come from 11 communities, and they've come from those same communities for 30 years. It's the same communities where we have the highest incidence of shots fired. So if you look at a shots fired map, you'll see the same community. It's the same community that brings the highest rates of juvenile arrests, same communities with public housing. So we drive past these communities, and we need to put the money back in those communities and bring our people back so that they can find success. We say this, I'll say this to you. Well, those of us who run programs, we talk about creating success among kids. I like to talk about it. It's really not true. You don't create success. Success is an attitude of the mind, and a longing of the mind, and an attitude of the heart. If we give kids and families the things that they need, they'll find success. That's the American story. You know, we're not going to give them success. That's nonsense. If we were, we wouldn't be having these panels. So we need to at least go back and talk about, what do we do? I mean, I think Patrick was right. What do we do with our own kids? You know, what works with our own kids, and start doing that?
I think absolutely. We now know what works. We have a lot of research and data that tells us what we should be doing. We have a responsibility to make sure that we have federal finance reform that allows us to do that. And I actually think the Child Welfare Demonstration Project and the expansion of that will give me the opportunity in Philadelphia to do all of the things that we've talked about today. And I think other systems should have that responsibility and opportunity as well.
Absolutely. We can and we need to. I mean, as everyone had highlighted earlier today, the sad reality is this system is failing, right? And we need to fix it. Most importantly, my brothers and sisters, who I consider everyone, every child that's in the foster care system, deserve and need this to be corrected. So absolutely, we can.
I think if we keep in mind that this is an emergency, each one of those children, this is an emergency in their life. This is not a case file. This is not business as usual. And we need to treat their cases as emergencies. That means we need to get them to a family. We need to get them connected. And I've always applied the my grandson test to it. But I was just in a meeting with community people yesterday, and they sort of took me up short and said, you should stop talking about foster kids. These aren't foster kids. These are our relatives. If we talk about our relatives and that we need to find homes for them, that we need to find education opportunities for them, that we need to find connections for them. These aren't somebody else's kids that we're helping. These are our kids. These are our relatives.
Yes, we can change the system. And we also have to understand that healing is relationship dependent. Children need relationship to receive the healing that needs to happen in their hearts, in their spirit, so they can be encouraged that they too can be successful. I think as a society, we've failed a lot of these children. They were innocent. They came into the system of care, none unbeknownst to them, because of their parents. And because the judge talked about the recycling, generations and generations of foster care, what are we doing as a system to break it? Yes, we can continue to start talking about having those conversations, saying the present system we have and recognizing those things within that system that doesn't take funding, but a change of heart.
Good point. The stage is set for final comments here from the panel. Go ahead, Judge.
I was just going to say that we have to be careful that we don't use kin as a replacement for the system. system needs to support kin when they do those things, not just a replacement, so that we place a fairly high number of children with non-licensed kin and they get a little bit of TANF support. We really need to redirect that and say, if you're kin and you're a placement for this child, we need to support you as well as we do anybody else.
Final points, Annie?
Just real quick, I think this unintended consequence piece is really important to look at. I would also ask that there be greater flexibility, not greater bureaucracy, in whatever we create. So don't make it harder for child welfare systems to do the right thing for kids.
Andre?
My closing remark would be, you have a diverse group of people here from different backgrounds within the system of care. When you form and are working within your own communities, be sure you have representation from everybody, and everybody's at the table making those decisions, and everyone understands their role and how it affects the other ones, and everybody is able to stay in their own lane.
Jeremy? Jarrell, I'm going to come to you for the last word.
I want to comment on what was said about your dad spending 20 years, did you say? Eight in an orphanage. I think that's interesting because when we look at the Children's Village data going back to 1848, we see that. So for 100 years, the kids that came to us were predominantly white, but they were poor Irish Catholic or non-English speaking new immigrants into New York. That was the kind of group. So they were either poor, they were Irish Catholic, or they were non-English speaking immigrants. And they tend to assimilate. What we are seeing since disproportionality became the driving force in the system, so that's about 35 years now, our kids of color are not assimilating in the ways that the majority white child who went through the orphanage system did. So just a comment to end with and say, that's a problem. That's a problem. We're not seeing the same results.
Jarrell, you get the last word.
So just this, to echo, the teamwork approach works best. And to fix it, I think all of the players, the panel, like having diversity is crucial, and highlighting it to be more flexible and not more restrictions, and just bringing the teamwork and everybody rolling up their sleeve and ready to work and fixing the system that's failing our young people.
As I turn the podium over to Lisa Hamilton, I want to thank the best panel ever.
You did a nice job. Thank you, guys.
I want to join Gary in echoing that you were fabulous as Build, and we certainly thank you for your time and your feedback, your perspective and passion will do nothing less than help us make this a better proposal. So thank you so much for that. Thank you for being a fabulous audience, for your questions and your comments. As I stated later, these are our ideas for consideration, and we hope it's the beginning of further conversation. Over the coming months, we are planning a series of meetings to invite any interested stakeholders to talk with us more about these ideas. You'll see in your packets that we've got the first of these meetings planned for December 4th, and it will focus on how 4E can help support best practices. Please check your inboxes for more information about that event. So with that, thank you all very much. Have a great day.